So let's give you an update on where we are with the GT50 program. So the last of the components for our direct drive starter generator unit are currently on the five axis machines being produced right here in-house at the moment. So over the course of this week, we've been producing the nose plate and just doing the finished machining on the casing, as well as the stub shaft that connects the rotor of the starter generator to the N1 rotor of the engine itself. Those bits are being produced at the moment. All of the stator and the magnetic components have already been made and are waiting to be assembled and tested. So the starter generator is almost there. The power management unit that controls and drives the starter generator, the design for that is now nearing completion and will be released for prototype manufacture over the course of the next week or so. Genu's just putting the finishing touches for that. We'll have the prototype boards back for that in a couple of weeks because they're relatively quick things to produce. And then we'll have both the hardware and the electronic components that drive it ready for testing on the high-speed test bench. The high-speed test bench that I've shown you before is on its way to PC1 as we speak and should be arriving in the next couple of weeks, ready to be installed up there in the test area. Working our way back through the engine, we've also completed all of the design work on the speed reduction gearbox, so the entire drivetrain, all of the drive shafts and torque measuring equipment. We've simplified the bevel box at the front and re-implemented the sprag clutch to decouple the engine from the rotor system. All of those components have completed their design, completed their analysis, completed all of the documentation that we need to do and have been released to production. The blanks for the gears in these stages are in production at the moment, and then we'll be releasing next week all of the casings so that we can start producing the prototype casings to get the first GT50 drivetrain on the test bench. The guys right now are now developing the test equipment to be able to run these drivetrains together on the bench to prove them out before we couple them to the broader engine. If we then turn our attention to the rotating components with the engine, the compressor design has been frozen for quite some time now. We're just really waiting for the temperature control to return to our machine shop to be able to finish the test impellers for the gas generator test. That's all wrapped up. The major focus of my attention and Mark's attention over the last couple of weeks has been the turbine blade casting process and heat treatment processes. Turbine blades are obviously extremely critical. They run at very, very high temperatures under very high loads and require very complicated materials. But the casting process is a process that's fraught with challenges to get good quality material out. And if I give you this example here, if you don't control everything properly, then even in critical areas like the root of your turbine blade, it's very easy to create porosity and voids for lots of different reasons. And these are the kinds of things that you have to get your process controls right to avoid having to cast 100 blades to get two good ones. And so what we've been doing over the course of the last couple of weeks is developing an absolutely state-of-art best practice approach to our filling design, to our molten metal management, and then to our casting process parameters to ensure that we fill the mold in the most careful and precise and controlled way that you possibly can. So we fully developed a new mold filling system. So this is part of the system that we're using now to cast a pair of turbine blades. We've got a very unique way of casting and getting the metal into the mold that eliminates a lot of the inherent difficulties with traditional vacuum forming processes. We're just designing some adapter plates at the moment to adapt an existing furnace, and then we'll be carrying out filling and ultimately the final casting process development trials over the next couple of weeks to get the first set of running GT50 turbine blades. In terms of the casting infrastructure here at PC1, over the last couple of days we've taken delivery of the first of the mold heating furnaces. So these are the furnaces that get the molds that we pour into up to the extremely high temperatures that they need to be at to enable us to cast properly. We're conducting some trials, some factory acceptance trials on a casting machine over in Germany in about 4 weeks' time, with our new process, with all of our process parameters as we want them in production. And as soon as that's accepted, that machine will be shipped over here to PC1 in the UK, giving us a full capability to make turbine blades here at PC1. In addition to the casting itself, we've also now almost completed the development of our heat treating processes. So as I said, casting is a very quirky process. When you pour liquid metal into a mold, many of the elements in there will come out of solution. You'll get a very inhomogeneous mixture of metals in the mold. You then have to heat treat it to get your metals back into solution and get uniform mechanical properties across the material. And then you have to age the material to get the atoms in the individual crystals in the right place within the crystal lattice. We've now got those processes developed. Once we get these turbine blades, we'll be validating that each of those processes meet the requirements that we need to hit the mechanical properties that we need to run these turbine blades in our engine. All of that work has been done over the course of the last 2 to 4 weeks, and we'll begin pouring trials either next week or the week after, and then full casting trials over in Germany in around 4 weeks. So really pleased with the progress on this. We're not far off now having all of the elements of GT50 ready and on the bench. So the heart of any turbine engine is the combustion system, getting the fuel in, creating nice uniform hot gases to drive the turbines and create the power. Over the course of the last 4 to 6 weeks, you've watched us expend extensive effort getting the fuel spray nozzles right, getting the swirlers right, getting the fuel system right, and also dealing with the complex fabrication of making the annular sheet metal combustion liner itself. This last week just gone, we finally managed to get the process right for making the last of the troublesome components of the combustion liner. So we can now fabricate this whole assembly. We've produced specialist tooling and specialist processes for each of these rolled sections and for the pressed sections at the back and at the front. And we've also developed specialist welding processes to laser weld these precision fabrications prior to them going into the CNC machine to be precision drilled to feed all of that mixing air and dilution air into the chamber. And this innocuous looking component was the final piece of the puzzle. This is the, goes that way round, this is the internal gooseneck fabrication that feeds the hot gases around the corner through the nozzle guide vane and into the first stage turbine. So really glad to finally have that one under our belts. In addition to that, the guys have been working extensively on optimizing the spray nozzles. We've gone for a dual orifice design with a primary nozzle to give you good atomization for starting, and then a secondary nozzle to throw in the volume of fuel that you need to generate the higher powers. This is far more complicated than it sounds, and it's taken a lot of development to get that right. We've got to the point now where within the next week or two, we'll have all of that geometry defined and ready for prototyping. And that will give us the full range of operations that we need for everything that the engine needs to do. To test that, we'll be extending the combustion test rig system that we've developed into a second generation test rig that will allow a series of three of the combustion nozzles and a quarter of the combustion chamber to run across the full operating range of the engine. And the benefit of that is it allows us to get far more instrumentation into the combustion chamber to really tune and optimize everything across all of the conditions that it'll need to see than we'd ever be able to do on an operating engine. So that will be developed over the course of the next month or so. And that then essentially is the final missing piece once we've got the other bits and pieces fabricated to getting the engine running on the test bench.